Every year at Christmas time, my husband and I watch the movie Love Actually. It's a funny and sometimes crude story about love. The part of the story that sticks with me, don't worry, this isn't a spoiler, is the airport scene. People arriving and departing to and from all over the world, greeting and saying goodbye to their loved ones. The message is that if you ever doubt that love and connection exist in the world, all you have to do is go hang out in an airport. Connection is everywhere. It happens in simple ways that we may not notice. Every time we plug in a light and every time we connect to Wi-Fi. It happens in more noticeable ways when we fall in love, when we see our newborn baby for the first time, when we go to a concert and hear our favorite song, when we dive into a cold lake, when we reach the top of a mountain, and when we say farewell to a loved one. Connection happens in unintentional ways, a shared laugh or a touch on the shoulder, a smile in the grocery store, holding the door for a stranger, or through random acts of kindness. We take it for granted. In its absence, we are more susceptible to stress, anxiety, depression, and loneliness. Disconnection has significant health implications and can result in distress that the body actually experiences as pain. Emotional pain can affect the body in a very similar way to physical pain. In fact, 2 aspirin can actually help ease the suffering of a broken heart. That said, many of us turn to a medicinal remedy to ease our pain. There certainly are some conditions that only medicine can cure, but for many of our ails, a greater sense of connection with ourselves, others, and the world is just what we need. We've just lived through a pandemic that has changed most of our lives forever. So many of us have lost loved ones. We've lived behind a mask for 2 years, limited our connections with people outside our families, worked from home, halted our travel, all of this while separating ourselves into those who believe a certain way and those who are wrong. A few weeks ago, the university that I work for lifted the mask mandate. This came with a mix of emotions for me, fear, angst, uncertainty, but mostly relief. I walked into the classroom for the first time without my mask, and I could see my students' faces for the first time. We smiled at each other, and I realized something really important. We've missed out on the reciprocity of our faces for 2 years. Humans and animals have mirror neurons in our brains whose sole purpose is learning and understanding emotions. In order to interpret and respond to others in social situations, we literally need to see each other's faces. As I got over the indecision to wear a mask or to not wear a mask, I allowed myself to feel the joy of returning a smile, of sitting face to face with a student, of going out in public with a little less fear, and a lot more connection. My 6-year-old son asked me the other day if I knew how to change the world. He'd just watched a video at school by Kid President, but I didn't know this. I was so curious about what would come next. His description of how to do things usually involves tape, glue, and the makings of an engine. His description of how to change the world is the best I've ever heard. You take the love in your heart and you share it with someone else, and then they share it, and then it spreads throughout the world. As he spoke, my mirror neurons were firing in response to his sparkly-eyed and innocent description of how to change the world. I felt the love. I realized that the moments of connection are sometimes hard to find, and sometimes we have to create them. John Gottman calls these small moments of connection deposits in the emotional bank account. If we imagine ourselves as containers, the more we respond to our loved ones' attempts at connection or bids, the fuller our emotional bank account becomes, so that when your loved one snaps at you in a moment of frustration, you have enough in the bank to prevent overdrawing. What all this means is that connection builds on itself. We can't always be positive, engaged, and fully present all the time. If anyone knows how, I'd love to know. What we can do is bring attention to how we show up in our relationships on a day-to-day basis. It's not the grand gestures that matter so much, although those are nice too. It's the little things. It's saying thank you is a touch, a smile. It's your tone of voice. It's a note or a text. It's what tells your people that you love them. It feeds their sense of belonging, and it helps them and us to feel connected. Let's talk about touch for a moment. Years ago, a psychological study showed that when baby monkeys were given a choice between a wire mother that provided only food and a cloth mother that provided only comfort, the monkeys would seek food from the wire mother, but when scared, tired, or lonely, the monkeys would choose the cloth mother every time. This was a famous study that taught us a lot about parenting. Children need comfort, a secure base, someone whom they can count on when they're sad, tired, or scared. The same is true for adults. We don't lose the need for comfort as we age. We may be socialized to believe that we do, but we don't. Comfort can come in many forms, a kind word, a glance, but the point here is that we need physical touch. In fact, there's now language to describe being deprived of touch. It's called skin hunger or touch starved. Touch stimulates release of the neurotransmitter oxytocin that makes us feel connected with others. It's actually been labeled the cuddle or love hormone. Touch can come in many forms. It can be a handshake at work, a hug from a friend, sitting close to a loved one. It can also come from getting a massage or having a manicure. The cool thing about this is that both people benefit, the person being touched and the person doing the touching. Research suggests that the best way to release oxytocin is to hug for 6 seconds. This is called the 6-second hug rule. Try it out the next time you hug a loved one. 6 seconds is a long time. Trust me when I say that the awkwardness is totally worth it and may make you and your loved one laugh when you don't let go. These efforts at connecting in our relationships require a certain amount of self-awareness. For some, this awareness comes naturally. We move through the world considering how we show up. Those mirror neurons help us to understand others' emotions and the effects we have on others. For others, self-awareness is uncomfortable, and it may be a stretch or even cause some anxiety to pause for a moment and consider how you might be perceived by others, how you're feeling, where tension is in your body, or how shallow your breaths are. Self-awareness contributes to our own sense of connection with ourselves and our ability to connect with others. Self-awareness is intricately connected with self-concept and self-esteem. A healthy balance of all three contributes significantly to our overall satisfaction in life and in our relationships. The happiest of people are comfortable in their own skin, confident in their ability to both succeed and survive failure, and believe they are worthy of love. Take a moment right now and breathe in some grace and breathe out self-criticism. We can all use a few of those nurturing breaths from time to time. Breathing is the most underutilized skill we possess. Deep breathing improves our posture, lowers our blood pressure, and helps to manage anxiety. It can also give us a reason to pause and notice what's happening around us, helping us make intentional decisions instead of acting on impulse. Try it for a moment. Take a deep breath, deep enough to fill your belly with air. Hold for about 3 seconds and let it out. As you let it out, let yourself sink a little into your chair and feel your shoulders drop. Try this a few more times and notice how much more present you can be in the moment. We're always filling time these days, standing in line at the grocery store, waiting for an appointment, even sitting in traffic, we reach for our phones. We can't stand the idleness when, in fact, it's in the moments of stillness that we can become the most connected with ourselves. In our ever-connected world, we're constantly measuring ourselves up to what we aspire. A 2019 survey revealed that the average American checks their phone 96 times per day. We seek knowledge, we shop, we post updates and photos, get a hit of dopamine whenever we get a like or a comment, and for some, this process of seeking approval and constant comparison may leave us feeling inadequate, lonely, and unsatisfied. Social media may lead us to believe we are connected, but for some can leave us feeling even more alone. What would it be like to accept ourselves for who and how we are? What would it be like to give ourselves some grace and compassion and to not decide our worth based on how we think we should be, but instead based on how we really are? I was recently asked to do an interview about how we forgive others for endangering our lives during the pandemic. As I reflected on this question, it felt so much bigger than a decision to wear a mask or to get vaccinated. It felt like a question of values. When we believe something different from someone else, we may jump to the conclusion that we hold different values than they do. Values run deep. If we act in ways that are contrary to our values, we experience cognitive dissonance. It's kind of like our conscience telling us not to be a hypocrite. When we experience this dissonance, we have to do something to set it right. Usually that means either changing our behavior or changing our values. You can probably guess that our behavior is more likely to change than our core value system. All of this is to say that when we're faced with a belief or behavior that runs counter to our values, we tend to vilify whoever did that thing or believes that way. This allows us to stay true to our values, but actually drives us farther away from connection with others. How do we make sense of things when the world we live in is so polarized? Is it possible to love someone or even like them if you don't agree with them? I propose that we try. Trying means listening to understand someone instead of to change their mind. Let them share their whole story and resist the urge to interrupt to share yours, or let your mind wander to formulating your response as you pretend to listen. Try reflecting back what you hear to check your understanding. You can still hold on to your values. No one can take those from you. Listening to understand might help you see that the way a person behaves and the things they have to say has everything to do with their values, and their values are good, whether you agree with them or not. When we don't feel heard, we say the same thing over and over again. When we feel heard, we feel known, understood, connected. Truly listening, purely for the purpose of understanding, can return the gift of compassion and empathy for another person. The makings of an authentic connection. My dad and I weren't always close. My parents were divorced when I was young, and I didn't spend a lot of time with him. When we spent time together, there was always something between us, preventing each of us from really understanding each other. We've worked on our relationship a lot over the years, and it's not always been easy. The best way I can describe what has happened is that the wall came down. I had a wall up to protect myself from his strong and impenetrable exterior. His strong and impenetrable exterior protected him from sharing his vulnerabilities and possibly getting hurt. When he trusted me enough to let me in, we were both vulnerable and we didn't need the wall anymore. Trust was important for both of us, and through listening and allowing ourselves to be known, I was able to develop compassion and empathy for all the things I didn't understand about my dad. And I believe he did the same thing for me. It turned out that our values weren't that different after all. Our relationship grew, but only because we let it. We have to be able to relate to someone, even in a very small way, in order to develop compassion for them. Their values might be vastly different from ours, but if we can relate to the idea that we all hold very tightly to our values, and that giving them up would be like giving up a piece of our bodies, now that's something I can relate to. You might be thinking, how can I relate to someone who's done terrible things to me or to other people that I care about? It's a protective mechanism to not allow ourselves to see a shared experience or a shared humanity with people who've hurt us, or perhaps who don't express remorse or repentance. How do we forgive? This is the million-dollar question. The answer is that you don't have to. Forgiveness is something you can choose to do because you want to, because you want to stop ruminating, because you want to improve your sense of wellness and overall well-being, because you want to release yourself from anger, resentment, all of the feelings that distress you when you think about it. Perhaps you need to forgive yourself for something you've done to someone else. because you can't carry the guilt anymore. Offering compassion and empathy to someone else or to yourself doesn't excuse the harm caused, doesn't pardon the behavior, and it also doesn't give permission for bad behavior to continue. What it does is it frees you from the past and paves the way for a more productive and satisfying future. Making your own meaning out of what happened and considering another's story as well as your own can lead to a greater sense of connection with yourself and with humankind. As you consider your own sense of connection in your life, ask yourself, how could I let others know me more? Is there something on your mind that you want to share? What are your hopes, your dreams, your fears? It's a risk to share those things with someone, and it requires a certain amount of trust that if you let someone know you, they're going to show up. Who do you want to know a little bit better? How can you get more real with yourself and real in your relationships? How can you really show up for those you care about? You can't control how others respond, the choices they make, the beliefs they hold, but you can influence them by spreading the love. And if you take the love in your heart and you share it with someone else, and they share it with someone else, we'll probably all experience the benefits of greater connection, and we may just change the world. Thank you.